Hello, welcome to The Vote with me, Frank LeDuc, and my guest today, Peter Kyle, the MP for Hove. Peter, thank you very much for joining us. We've shot one programme in this current week. I'll drag you back for more. And I wanted to ask you about how your journey's going up to Westminster these days. What are the trains like?
Well, in the run-up to recess, I was commuting up and down every single day because my friend who I used a sofa bed in his house and slept over a couple of nights a week, he's moved house, so I had to start the commute every single day rather than a few times a week.
Ouch.
Yeah, and it was, it's tough. I mean, I know, I've always commuted, I've commuted for a long time now, and I know just how tough the experience is for people. And also, I hear from and communicate with a lot of people every single day, so I've always known just how awful it is. I mean, it is, what's happened on the trains has affected people's lives, relationships, their livelihoods, our community, our economy. Yeah. It has been a wrecking ball through
quite
the
a long
of
running
our community
one.
Here.
Yeah. I mean, it's been running for almost the whole time you've been an MP, I think. There's been
it started soon after. It really descended quite soon after me being MP.
I mean, it was
MP,
brewing up, wasn't it?
No.
But I mean, it was kind of brewing up. They're sort of in the autumn after you're elected, and then it just from the Easter after you're elected, so almost a year
the
on.
The seeds for this were sown in long-term historic underinvestment in this line, but the real challenge came.
And in the staff.
The real challenge came after Cameron and Osborne focused on HS2.
Yes.
HS2 is such an enormously, huge undertaking for the Department of Transport that they diverted every bit of resource towards getting that right. They took their eye off the biggest single transport challenge our country has, getting people from the southeast of England in and out of London every day for work.
Yeah.
And in that 4 or 5 year period, everything descended. Nobody took ownership.
Southern used to be a good company.
Oh, absolutely.
In everyone's eyes.
But also, it's not just Southern. I mean, remember that the timetable is set by government. The revenue goes directly to government.
Unusually as well for train companies.
Government have, they control every aspect of this contract. It's not a franchise, it's a contract. And government control every single bit. The money doesn't go to Southern or to GTR. It goes directly to the government. And government were looking elsewhere.
Yeah.
They took their eye off the ball. All these issues, including industrial action, I said all the way through this, could only be solved when government got actively involved. And isn't it interesting that just a couple of weeks ago, the thing that solved it was Chris Grayling picking up the phone and saying, I'll speak to you directly.
And it's happening
next week.
I mean,
why didn't he do that a year earlier? I was saying it. I was saying it to his face. I was saying it in the House of Commons, pick the phone up and speak to them.
Well, they're going in to see him next week, apparently. So
of course, but now they've, so that's the
so
single...
They've called off the immediate threats of strikes, both ASLEF and the RMT. And if you'll forgive the cliched metaphor, is there a light at the end of the tunnel?
No, I think there is. And if this industrial action is settled into the longer term, we will see an immediate improvement in services.
Yeah.
But we now need to realise that the scale of investment needed in this line is huge. Yeah. And because of the group that I set up with Nicholas Soames, which has delivered and spoken on behalf of every single MP in the whole area, we have leveraged £320 million in a year out of the government to invest in that track immediately. But what they haven't done is agreed to repeat that for the next 4 years. If we can do that, we will have, at the end of that 5 years, a transformed experience on the line.
Yes.
Because of the 5% year upon year improvement increase in passenger numbers, we're always going to have a strain on that system. It's always going to be difficult. And until, which is what Labour guaranteed to do in its manifesto, we have a second line between London and Brighton, ultimately, into the very long term, I'm talking about the next generation, we are not going to be able to have the kind of bulletproof service that people deserve.
I mean, one of the things that struck me about this, Peter, is that on the surface, it's been a row about who closes the train doors, who's responsible for the safety of passengers being on the train before it pulls out of the station. But it strikes me what it really seems to be about is how you change. That the government and the rail companies want to have driver-only trains because they're cheaper to run, basically. In a big part of that, and they tend to stick closer to the timetable. By and large, it seems. I mean, and we run the London Underground like this, Thames Link runs like this, but the row seems really to be about whether management companies can impose change or whether they negotiate with their staff and, as far as possible, agree changes, even if it means being incremental, doing it step at a time.
So I agree with the second bit of your proposition, not entirely the first. The change for this isn't just about efficiency.
Yeah.
People's behaviour change, people's patterns change. People expect a different degree of customer service today than they did 20 years ago. And so the function and role of conductors on trains has changed. It's changed in most of the country. It's changed on Thameslink.
Yes, but
it's
not which is the same company as Southern.
Which is the same company. So modernisation is being driven by consumers and the public. It's not always being driven just by politicians and policymakers.
Yeah.
So the need for modernisation, adaptation and evolution of job roles is one that's going on in every other sector, every other walk of life, every other bit of our economy. And the train system shouldn't be and isn't immune to it.
Okay.
But secondly, there were, I think government, you are right in that, these things need to happen and that government needed to handle it better. Yeah. These changes have been handled unbelievably bad. It is a case study in how not to modernise.
Yes.
And it is, once again, this government, they've done it to the NHS, they've done it to other public services, they're doing it now to the police service. They screw up modernisation. They give modernisation a bad name.
I mean,
they give reform a bad name, and they've done it again now.
I mean, you quite often have tensions, don't you? You're always going to have, when you have change, winners and losers, people who don't like the changes. I mean, some unions seem to have found a way of working better with employers to bring about modernisations in their industry, but quite often it seems to have come after a particularly horrible fracture. In some cases, with coal mining, we've lost the industry effectively, and for one reason or another. With other industries, it seems to have gone differently. Like you say, I suspect it's a bit of a case study.
One of the things I want to achieve in politics, I call myself a modernizer. I want to be there to make sure public services reflect people's lives.
Yeah.
And not just lives today, but the way that people's lives are changing and evolving over time in the future, to take account of people's expectations in health, in education, in crime prevention and all the rest of it, and also in transport. So what the government is doing by giving reform and modernisation such a bad name is making it incredibly difficult for people, for the public and politicians like me to make the case for change, because people now associate change with strikes, with strife, with poor performance, with underperformance, as an excuse to impose austerity. These are all the things this government has done, and it's an absolute crime. I mean, it is absolutely appalling, and it is there's no doubt in my mind it's going to hold our country back for years to come until we can get an administration in there that can run things.
This wouldn't by any chance be a Labour administration,
would it? thanks for finishing my thought process.
On industrial relations, just briefly, presumably you welcomed the court ruling that employment tribunal fees were too high and preventing people from seeking redress if they were treated badly at work.
Of course I do. And it's really interesting, in that first Cameron-Osborne government, the coalition, all these things happened under the radar because there's such a blitz of reform that some of it never made it into the public conscience. One of the things that was most pernicious was extending the right to tribunal from 1 year to 2 years, so that people who started people who start a new job at the
went
time
back to didn't, 2 years.
You couldn't go back you yeah. couldn't go back go to tribunal for the first year probation period.
Yes.
They extended it to 2 years.
Yes.
And when you see the people who are going into work at the moment who are extremely vulnerable, they're low paid, these
and
are people who are terrified even to talk about difficulties in the workplace.
Yeah,
and this is I'm the one that took on Mike Ashley and tried to get him to reform. I did it on the select committee. I went to Shirebrook to challenge him in his own workplace, but when I see the government actually incentivizing people to become vulnerable and not to speak up in the workplace for the first 2 years, then this really worries me. This is the kind of thing that's changed quite profoundly in the workplace. So yes, of course, I think what the unions did by taking this and spending so much money and resource by taking this through the court process,
this is the sort of action by unions. This is the sort of action by unions you'd much prefer to see, I suspect. We've got about a minute and a half left. I just wanted to stay in the legal sphere and ask you about another subject we've spoken about before and that you've campaigned on: domestic violence and women facing men who've abused them across the courtroom. I just wonder if you could just, have you made any progress on this front?
Yeah. Well, now the law hasn't gone through Parliament yet, so. I found out through somebody who came to see me in a surgery that a woman who had been abused, her abuser had been convicted and jailed for abuse. What he did to her was unbelievable, and from prison was suing for custody of the child, not because he wanted custody of the child, but it's because he wanted to personally cross-examine his victim in court.
Continue the abuse.
Under the nose of judges and the police, the people who were there to protect them. I thought this was grotesque. I found out it was true, it was happening, it was widespread. And then through the campaign, a six-month campaign, working with other brilliant MPs, some of whom have been campaigning for a very long time, we got the law changed. Yeah. The legislation is still going through. This is the first step. Family, what happens in family courts is the most secretive part of our society outside of the military. And what we need to do is shed more light on it. I've been to see the president of the family courts, Lord Justice Mumby.
Yes.
And I've had a very frank conversation. I'm the first backbencher that's ever been to see him and had a big session with him. And there's a couple of other areas that I'm really keen to get cracking on now.
Well, brilliant. I'm pleased about that. We're going to take a quick break for these ads. Please don't go away. Join us after these ads. Hello, welcome back to The Vote with me, Frank LeDuc, and my guest today, Peter Kyle, the MP for Hove. Peter, thanks for joining us here on the home straight. I'm going to change the subject now. Well, thanks very much for taking us through very briefly. I appreciate that was a bit of a rattle of domestic violence. Progress on that front is quite, it must seem very hard sometimes as one of 650 MPs when you're not in government to try and get the ear of ministers who have got no interest in making you look good or getting things done on your behalf and making progress. And
the learning curve for being an MP is a very steep one. And I'm always very keen to talk about this because I think what we have to do as MPs, we're forced to do, is appear bulletproof and like massively thick skins and all the rest of it. But I think that puts young people off in particular because it doesn't make you look human. But actually being open about the fact there are moments of sheer terror in this job. I mean, now, for example, facing you. And there are moments in every single day of sheer terror. The House of Commons chamber is a beast. And it is difficult, and there is a lot of people trying to get in, learning the dynamic, understanding the dynamic of your own party, your own PLP, understanding how the Commons works. Sitting there and learning who makes change. You know, why is it when that person stands up that people take notice and listen and things happen, but yet when that person stands up and does it, no one does? You know, why is that? Understanding that and trying to become the best MP I can possibly have. And if I hadn't won that election in June this year, the one thing that would have really dogged me was I knew at that point I wasn't the best MP that I had the potential to be because I hadn't had enough time to become that person yet, that MP. So hopefully,
continuing to practice, as it were.
Yeah.
Well, one of the nicer parts of your calendar, if you like, is coming up this weekend, and that's Pride. Mm-hmm. Are you going to be there?
Yeah, and damn right I'll be there. I've never missed a Pride. I mean, I've not missed a Pride for a very long time, but I've never missed one since I've become a candidate. I think it's incredibly important for people to see politicians there.
And I have to say, across party in Brighton and Hove, you generally do as well. It's not, I don't think it's a party political thing, is it? I don't think so. I mean, Pride started as a protest, and now it's a glorified party. Brighton's biggest party.
No. It's not a glorified anything. What it is many things on the same day. And it is still protest, it is still political, and it is now also a huge party in celebration. And, hell, why not? Why not allow gay people to go and have a really good party for the day? Because believe me, when you look at the stories for the last 50 years and
I was gonna say
beyond,
50 years this year,
I think we've earned it. But also always bear in mind in Pride, and I know this firsthand because it was me, the first time I marched in Pride was terrifying. Because you think everybody who's out there is looking at you going, oh, he's gay, is he? When of course nobody notices you. But for you, it's a huge statement.
Well,
so I'm always
looking
around. They
do notice you now.
I look around and I'm always very, very aware that there are people who are marching for the first time. And for them, it is the biggest moment of their life. And there will be people in the audience, in the crowds, standing silently with their heart beating loudly, thinking, shall I just go in there and march or not?
Yeah.
I'm not ready for this. Or they're looking at the people marching, thinking, I think I belong in there, but I'm not sure yet. So I'm always incredibly aware that there's that side of it as
well.
There's a very sensitive personal side to Pride as well, which gets hidden amongst all of the noise and the glamour and the flamboyance.
I do love the noise, the flamboyance, the glamour.
Well,
though,
I'm sure you're planning on what you're going to wear.
You don't want to know. A few weeks ago, the government announced public inquiry into the contaminated blood scandal of the 1970s and 80s. And it always strikes me as strange how these things happen. You know, there's a scandal, it's long before almost anyone in the House of Commons was actually there, certainly before any of the members of the government were involved. And yet there seems to be, whichever party it is, it's not a uniquely yeah. conservative thing. There's this defensiveness about, and I guess it's easy to say, yes, we'll have a public inquiry and spend another, you know, they all cost money to hold and etc. But I mean, I don't know what your feelings are about the fact that at last this issue, which, you know, people who were given blood transfusions were then ended up very ill as a result of what was supposed to help.
They died.
Indeed.
And so I've got a constituent who lost his father in there. And when I read his messages, you know, it's upsetting. Yeah. It's really upsetting. So the public inquiry for him is incredibly important. I lost a very good friend of mine through this. So Anita Roddick, the co-founder of the Body Shop, she died because of contaminated blood.
Yeah.
She contracted hepatitis C when she gave birth to her youngest child, Sam. You know, so, and she was my mentor. I wouldn't be sitting here today without her. And you know, she was, in many ways, a surrogate mum to me in the way that she sort of mentored and nurtured me.
Yes. Yeah.
You know, and the world lost this inspiration.
Very young. Yeah.
Because of contaminated blood. We need to understand what the hell happened.
Yeah.
You know, what led to this once? What led this to happen time and time and time and time again? People getting HIV and dying of AIDS. People getting hepatitis. People getting a whole range of diseases and viruses through blood in a hospital which is sanctioned by the government. Mm. You know, there is something that is absolutely corrupt about this, and we need to find out how, when, why, and to make sure it'll never, ever happen again. And the relatives of the survivors get the answers that they need in the spirit that they need, because I don't think we're quite there yet.
No, I was going to say, we've had a couple of inquiries into this before, but that never really seemed to have satisfied.
This has got to be fully independent. You know, at the moment, there are very strong links to the Department of Health, which I'm looking into.
Yes.
So I want to make sure that the survivors of this,
have got
the
confidence.
Families of people who have lost loved ones because of this, have confidence in it. At the moment, we're not quite there.
And at the same time, we're seeing a national shortage of blood donors locally and nationally, particularly after the Manchester terror attacks, you know, for example. And that it was highlighted then with a plea for publicity. I get sent pleas for publicity by the NHS Blood and Transplant, the body that wants people to register to donate their organs as well.
And of course, I'm not allowed to give blood.
Well, I was going to ask you about this. There's been a campaign to relax. They're quite rigorous, the rules around who can and can't give blood.
Well, the most absurd thing is that gay people can't give blood for two years after they've had sex. You know, it's absurd. I mean, with all the technology in the world, bearing in mind the conversation about contaminated blood.
And we have blood, we have Pride once a year.
Exactly, yeah. So. Yeah.
I won't go. Yeah.
A huge sections of the population are being excluded for no apparent reason when we have the medical device. Now, there is a campaign which has just succeeded just last week, and the government have now agreed to reduce that to a two-month window. And that's going to enable a lot more people to give blood. But again, that wasn't just a scientific or a medical issue. It was an issue of equality. You know, why sex workers were allowed to give blood but gay people weren't, you know, it seems to me pretty
strange.
Yeah. Well, and pretty unjustifiable.
Yes. And I mean, part of this as well, the medical side of it, if you like, is I guess one of the things that's changed since the tainted blood scandal of the 70s and 80s is where we are able to tell much more quickly about our health these days, to diagnose many conditions so that we can check whether somebody is fit enough, well enough to give their blood.
No, absolutely. And, you know, I'm very involved in the work of Pt2 and Stonewall and
Terence
other sexual...
Higgins Trust.
Yeah, yep. And other sexual health charities. I encourage people actively to go and get tested. I get tested every year for HIV.
I've watched them draw your blood at the Pt2, the Terence Higgins Trust here.
Yeah, and I put my money where my mouth is, and I went and had a full sexual health checkup just recently. You know, so I think it's easy.
Yep.
You know, it's not a pleasant thing to go through, but it's an important thing to go through. And I encourage everyone, not just gay people. I think every young people...
People who are sexually active and maybe in high risk groups.
Always bear in mind that the highest risk group at the moment is middle-aged divorcees.
Eek.
So, you know, these are people who think that they're beyond
the
age where you're going to get these things,
I mean,
and they're not. So we've got to make sure that this is an issue that affects everyone. We need to be really serious and frank about it, you know. So if I can go and get tested for all these things, there's no reason why anyone else can't.
I know, absolutely. And HIV testing, it's not a contentious issue across party these days. There are fewer new diagnoses. There's better treatment, better drug treatment, better life expectancy, better general health if you have HIV.
But as always, the people who need to get tested the most are the people who are least likely to do so.
Yep.
So we need to make sure that it's not just well-educated, middle-class people who read all the information and get access to all the information and make the logical decision to do the right thing are the ones who get tested. We need to make sure that everybody gets the information in the way that actually inspires the kind of
action
and behaviour change that we need.
And the reason I was sort of, what I was leading up to, I guess in a way, is that apart from the fact you know, took part in the Westminster Hall debate about this not all that long ago, was that the Sussex Beacon locally has been through some, you know, we've got things like the Golden Handbags, the half marathon, which raised great amounts of money for it, but it's faced a bit of a funding crisis. Are we through that?
No, we're not through that. And you know, I'm a very active patron and huge supporter of the Sussex Beacon. This is because of the reforms that the government have made to HIV funding. They have taken HIV funding away, and then they've fractured the route to funding. Now, if you are, you know, outpatients get separate funding to inpatients, preventative work gets another funding stream. Some of it is local, some of it is regional, and some of it is central through an HIV fund. Now, if you're an organisation like the Sussex Beacon that does all of these things, it has inpatient, outpatient, and preventative work.
They're a triple whammy,
exactly.
Really.
They have 12 patient beds and provide 2,000 bed nights a year. Now, imagine if the Sussex Beacon goes, are they going to go to the Royal Sussex?
Yeah.
They're certainly not, because there's no space for it. So we cannot allow this facility to go under. And the government have created a system of funding for HIV care, which is designed to clobber organisations like the Sussex Beacon.
It might well have been designed to. I don't think it specifically was. Very briefly, very briefly, yes, the future, comfortable that they will get through this.
No. Okay. So the Beacon
is now doing. Keep raising money for the Beacon.
The Beacon is now doing a fantastic partnership with Terence Higgins Trust. You know, there's a degree of security that wasn't there 6 months ago. But let's be really clear. You know, any HIV charity, including THT and Stonewall,
we've got to stop it there. But I would say, keep supporting these charities. Thanks for joining me, and please watch again soon. Goodbye.